Amen, amen. Praise God. Well, thank God we can sing that song, can talk about dancing with our Lord, our Master, our Messiah, because He is risen. We celebrated last weekend about how He was getting ready to go pay that ultimate price for us all. But today is a day of celebration. My kids keep asking me, why are we going back again? I was like, well, this is a very, very, very special day. When you go and you see that grave was empty, and you know why He did it. It's interesting. It's that why we pay so much attention to this day, Yom HaBikurim, the Resurrection Day. It's because out of the three major monotheistic religions in the world, or faiths in the world, one believes that Yeshua never died. Another believes that He died but didn't raise again. But we know that not only did He die, not only did He rise, but He's now seated where He belongs, at the right hand of the Father, making propitiation for us. That is why we are all able to come here. That's why we worship Him. Without that fact, our faith is meaningless. So praise God for that. So again, welcome once again. And as we just a couple of announcements, just to kind of repeat. So it's going to be May 23rd, where we'll be celebrating Shavuot, the day of Pentecost. And not only that, but we'll be blessed with the Seders with us once again from Messianic Dance Camp International. So we'll be having a lot of dancing going on there, and I'm pretty sure she has a lot of new steps for us to learn. So yeah, so we'll keep announcing that as the time comes. So that's pretty much, just want to keep this short and sweet so we can get back to what this day is about. Shem Yeshua.
Hallelujah. You know, it's interesting. This is a day that we're actually not commanded to assemble. Actually not, of all the high holy days. The interesting thing about it, though, is I kind of look at it like dessert. How often do we have to, like, convince ourselves to eat dessert? Do we really need a command to do that? No. No, there's just some things we want to do. And when we talk about the resurrection of our Lord, we should want to celebrate His resurrection. It's a victory this morning. It's a victory. Love wins over hate. The demons, the darkness, the devil, all have been defeated. We have the victory in Him. It's the cornerstone of what we believe. It's the cornerstone of our faith. The resurrection of Yeshua HaMashiach from the dead. You take away this with incredible event, as the brother was sharing, our faith is what? What are we doing here? What we're doing here, we're just going through some religious rituals. Rituals and moral and ethical conduct. Now, you may be interested to know that resurrection does not mean to rise up. It actually does not mean that. You know, if you think about it, if He was in the cave or the tomb, He'd probably bump His head if He rose up. We don't want that to happen. But no, resurrection literally means exiting. It means going out, leaving death. And if the Messiah had not been raised, declares Rabbi Shaul, your trust is useless. Central to the good news for all humanity is Yeshua's atoning work on the tree and His resurrection from certain death. It is the most significant event that has ever happened in existence. There is nothing that surpasses the defeat of death, the resurrection of death, from death of our Messiah, and the potential for all of us who confess His name, believe in our hearts, and follow Him. He's our first fruits. That's Yom HaBikurim, the first fruits. The first harvest is barley. He's our first fruits from the dead. And for those of us who will believe, we will also experience that victory over death. The execution tree and the Messiah's resurrection from the tomb represents the heart of what it is to be a people of His way. That's what this morning's Yom Tehillah Resurrection Day celebration is all about. Yeshua. Yeshua. He's the firstborn from the dead who is alive. And because he lives, so shall we. Amen. Please rise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Join me. Well, you're not going to join me, but you're going to hum along with me. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam borei pri hagafen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who creates the fruit of the vine. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has chosen us from all the peoples and sanctified us by your commandments, and you have given us in love, O Lord our God, holy festivals for gladness and sacred seasons for joy, this day of Yom HaBikurim, the resurrection of our Messiah. Blessed are you, O Lord, King of the universe, who has kept us in life and has preserved us and enabled us to reach this season. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam asher natalanu et derech ha-yeshua b'mashiach Yeshua. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has given us the way of salvation in Messiah Yeshua. When we will turn to the east this time, Shema Yisrael, Yahweh Eloheinu, Yahweh Echad, Baruch Shem, Kevod Malchuto, Leolam Vayed. Hear, O Israel, Yahweh is our God, and Yahweh is one. And blessed be his name, whose glorious kingdom is forever and ever. And you shall love Yahweh your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your might. And these words which I am commanding you today shall be on your heart. And you shall teach them diligently to your children. And you shall talk of them when you sit in your house, and when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise up. And you shall bind them as a sign in your hands, and they shall be as frontals on your forehead. And you shall write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates. And you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Father, we look to the east, and in the east is a great wall, and people pray to that wall. But Father, there are walls of indifference in hearts and minds that resist the good news and truth of Yeshua's resurrection. Father, I pray that we would shout and declare to that wall, like the walls of Jericho, that we would shout the truth that Yeshua is risen. He's risen indeed. Death has been defeated, and we shall live as he lives. B'Shem Yeshua, do you agree? Amen, amen and amen. May be seated.
There shall be a highway in the desert for the redeemed of the Lord. And from the mouth of the Lord of hosts shall go forth a fiery sword. And all the world will see Yeshua, and all the world will see salvation, and all the world will see Yeshua, and all the world will see he is King. There shall be a fountain in the city, all the people from sin, and with the tree of life in the midst of her for the healing of the nation.
all the world will see that reality. Amen. Hallelujah. What is this holiday all about? We have a world right now all showing up in their Easter bonnets and white shoes and Easter baskets, and they're all in church and they're celebrating Easter. And what, let's find out what the Bible says. We read from Leviticus 23, verse 9. And Adonai said to Moshe, tell the people of Israel, after you enter the land I'm giving you and harvest its ripe crops, you are to bring a sheaf of the first fruits of your harvest to the Kohen, or the priest. And he is to wave the sheaf before Adonai so that you will be accepted. The Kohen is to wave it on the day after the Shabbat. You are not to eat bread, dried grain, or fresh grain until the day you bring the offering for your God. This is a permanent regulation through all of your generations, no matter where you live. Now, traditionally, the celebration of Yom HaBikurim in Israel, the young men, you know, it was a big, big deal, bigger than any other holiday. They would wash their little cysts, what they were called, and they would start with the harvest together with the young woman dressed in robes or bright robes. They following them into the you know, into the fields, and they would harvest the sheaves, and they'd wave them as offering, dancing in the fields, grateful for what God has provided. But for the most part, this holy day of Yom HaBikurim is overlooked. It's overlooked. I don't get it. But it's overlooked by Jews. It's overlooked by Christians, certainly overlooked by Muslims, but it's overlooked by Messianics. But that wasn't always the case in the days of the temple. Then it was pretty elaborate ceremony with the priests leading praise and worship service, and like we're doing with psalms and dance, like in Yom HaBikurim, or sometimes called Sefirah HaOmer, was the first harvest of the spring, and which, of course, as I said, was the barley harvest. The grain would be brought before the priest as an offering, and he would take the sheaves of the Omer, and he would lift it high in the air, waving in all directions, which we're going to do during our service at one point. He waved it in all directions, acknowledging the God on high, his faithfulness to provide our every needs. And it's no coincidence that these rituals of the harvest coincide with the death and the burial and the resurrection of Messiah Yeshua, which I elaborated on somewhat during Passover. While he was being bound and executed, at the same time the barley in the field were being bound and ready to be cut. And the journey the barley would take to be presented to the priest at the temple is not unlike the journey that Yeshua, set free from the bounds of this earth, took himself to his Father's house. The barley was the first harvest with more to come. After 49 days of daily lifting up the sheaves of barley to God, the 50th day represented another harvest. And that harvest would be the harvest of wheat on Shavuot. And likewise, following his resurrection on the 50th day, Yeshua would, he would send us his, or his ascension, he would send us his comforter, the Ruach, to be with us until his return. Now, for us as people of Yeshua's way, this holy day, though overlooked, holds the most significance of all the high holy days for us as the day that our Messiah defeats death. Rabbi Shaul agreed with that. He, way back when, writing to Corinth, he says, but the fact is that the Messiah has been raised from the dead. The fact is. That he's been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have died. For since death came through a man, also the resurrection of the dead has come through a man. For just as in connection with Adam all die, so in connection with the Messiah all will be made alive. But each in their own order. Messiah is the first fruits, and then those who belong to the Messiah at the time of their coming. All will rise according to their relationship with Yeshua. Amen?
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He straight, my song. This cornerstone is solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still with striving seas. My comforter, my all in all, hearing the love of Christ, I stand in Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in heaven was made. This gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Yeshua died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live.
There it is.
Remain standing and join me with the traditional rendering of what's called the Amida or the Amida. It's scripture, it's liturgy, but there are many things to be declared here that are significant for people of the way. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth shall declare your praise. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, and God of our fathers, God of Abraham, God of Yitzhak, and God of Yaakov, the great, mighty, and revered God, the most high God who bestows loving kindnesses and is master of all things, who remembers the pious deeds of the patriarchs and in love has brought a redeemer to their children's children for your name's sake. O King, helper, savior, and shield, blessed are you, O Lord, the shield of Abraham. You, O Lord, are mighty forever. You revive the dead. You are mighty to save. You sustain the living with loving kindness. You revive the dead with great mercy. You support the falling. You heal the sick. You free the bound. And you keep the faith to them that sleep in the dust. Who is like you, Lord of mighty acts, and who resembles you, O King, and orders death and restores life and causes salvation to spring forth? You are the Lord God, appointed times for gladness, festivals and seasons for joy, this day of Yom HaBikurim, the season of our resurrection. Our God and God our fathers, may our remembrance ascend, come and be accepted before you with the remembrance of our fathers, of Messiah, the son of David, your servant who reserved of the Yerushalayim, your holy city, and of all your people of the way, bringing deliverance and well-being, grace, loving kindness and mercy, life and peace on this day of Yom HaBikurim. Remember us, O Lord our God, for our well-being, and be mindful of us for blessing, and save us unto life by your promise of salvation and mercy. Spare us and be gracious to us. Have mercy upon us and save us, for our eyes are bent upon you, because you are a gracious and merciful God and King. O Lord our God, bestow upon us the blessing of your holy Moedim for life and peace, for joy and gladness, even if you have been pleased to promise that you would bless us. Bless us with your commandments and grant our portion in your Torah. Satisfy us with your goodness and gladden us with your salvation. Purify our hearts to serve you in truth and let us inherit, O Lord our God, with joy, gladness, your holy days, and may all who sanctify your name rejoice in you. Blessed are you, O Lord, who sanctifies his chosen and consecrates the festive seasons. Amen. You may be seated.
The moon and stars, they wept. The morning sun was dead. The Savior of the world was fallen. His body on the cross, his blood poured out for us, the weight of every curse upon him. One final breath he gave as heaven looked away. The sun of God was laid in darkness. A battle in the grave. The war on death was waged. The power of hell forever broken. The ground began to shake. The stone was rolled away.
sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome.
Praise the Lord. You know, there's a phenomenon that is, I think we're all aware of these days. It's basically, it's sweeping through our country. And it's called the cancel culture. Anybody aware of the cancel culture? Yeah, I'm sure you are. The cancel culture, it's a mindset. It's a mindset that demands that if anyone says or does something that someone else might find offensive, that person must be silenced and he must be destroyed, his life destroyed. And as a result, people have lost their jobs, their careers, their reputations, and they've even had their lives threatened. See, there's kind of a mob mentality out there that attacks people even for things they did 20, 30, 40 years ago. Oh, my goodness, I could keep them real busy 30, 40 years ago. You don't have to agree so loudly. I don't think you were born. Strike that from the... But it's happening, and we know it's happening. It's happening to ministry leaders. It's happening to politicians. It's happening to candidates for the Supreme Court. It's happening to actors. It's happening to comedians. It's happening to media types, business people, educators, and even cartoon characters. Are you kidding me? Not Pepe Le Pew. Goodness. Of course, Speedy Gonzales, I can't talk about that. And children's books like Dr. Seuss and The Muppets. And they're all being forced, being canceled because somebody somewhere is offended. Now, that's not to say that there aren't people who should have been canceled years ago, but this cancel culture seems driven by a kind of sanctimonious self-righteousness, a self-righteous hatred. It's kind of scary. It really is. Yeah, and actually, though, this desire to destroy others is as old as humankind. Think about Cain, canceled Abel. How about Joseph's brothers attempted to cancel him? How about Jezebel, who tried to cancel Eliyahu or Elijah? And it went on and on throughout history. However, no one has found or faced the cancel culture more than Yeshua. It was the cancel culture that put him on the stake. A cancel culture that hated Yeshua so much that it killed him. And when he was nailed to the tree, people rejoiced, believe it or not. The same people that probably rejoiced when he came to deliver him now rejoicing that he's on the tree. They rejoiced because Yeshua had finally been canceled, or so they thought. But unlike others who have been canceled by culture, Yeshua wasn't a victim. The attempt to destroy Yeshua had been planned by God for centuries. In fact, Kephar, Peter, revealed this when he preached on Shavuot, or Pentecost. Men of Israel, he said, listen to this. Yeshua from Nazareth was a man demonstrated to you to have been from God by the powerful works, miracles, and signs that God performed through him in your presence. You yourselves know this. This man was arrested in accordance with God's predetermined plan and foreknowledge. And through the agency of persons not bound by the Torah, you nailed him up on a stake and you killed him. And Rabbi Shaul, or the Apostle Paul, similarly wrote, for among the first things I passed on to you was what I also received, namely this. The Messiah died for our sins in accordance with what the Tanakh, or the Old Testament, says. And he was buried, and he was raised on the third day in accordance with what the Tanakh says. You know it. You read the book. Shouldn't be any surprise here. His execution had been planned. Yeshua's death had been on purpose, and the cancel culture did exactly what God predetermined they would do. It was all part of God's design. Now, with that thought in mind, I want to look at the events that Yochanan, or John, tells us about in chapter 19 of the Gospel of John, as Yeshua hung on that tree. First event I want to look at is we're told that the soldiers gambled for Yeshua's robe at the foot of the stake. Now, when the soldiers had nailed Yeshua to the stake, they took his clothes and divided them into four shares, a share for each shoulder with the underrobe left over. Now, the underrobe was seamless, woven in one piece from top to bottom, so they said to one another, we shouldn't tear it in pieces. Let's draw for it. And this happened in order to fulfill the words from the Tanakh of the Old Testament. They divided my clothes among themselves and gambled for my robe. And this is why the soldiers did these things. Now, notice it says this was to fulfill the words of Scripture. But why? Why? Why had God even bothered to make this prophecy? Well, we're not told. We're not. But I've got at least some idea why, which I'm going to share with you. Despite what you might have seen in various paintings and movies or sculptures, when the Romans crucified people, they stripped them down bare. They stripped them down bare. That was the Roman way of crucifixion. Their intention was to cause as much suffering and humiliation as possible, embarrassing their victims by exposing them and robbing them of any form of modesty or decency. And I'm aware of alternative points of view regarding this being, or his being naked. The Romans allowing, some would say, a loincloth out of consideration for Jewish tradition and being sensitive with his mother present. But it's hard in the context of what took place there to find any support that there was a sensitivity by either the Jewish leaders or the Roman leaders towards Messiah Yeshua. There's nothing there that lends to that point of view. But still the question arises, why would God prophesy about people casting lots for his garments? And my suspicion is this, God wanted us to focus on Messiah's clothing. He wanted us to remember Yeshua was naked on the stake. There's a book, it's called The Hiding Place. Most of you are cognizant of that book. Maybe you've read it. Corrie Ten Boom told of her experience in the Nazi prison. She wrote, every Friday, the Nazis made the prisoners completely undressed for medical inspection. The women were humiliated, having to march by the grinning guards. On one of those morning, she writes, "Yet another page in the Bible leapt into life for me. He hung naked on the cross. I had not known," she says, "I had not thought, the paintings, the carved crucifixes showing at least a scrap of cloth, but this I suddenly knew was the respect and reverence of the artist. But oh, at the time itself, on that other Friday morning, there had been no reverence, no more than I saw in the faces around us now. And I leaned forward, my sister Betsy, ahead of me in line. Her shoulder blade stood out sharp and thin beneath her blue, matted skin. Betsy, they took his clothes too. And ahead of me, I heard a gasp. Oh, Corey, or Carrie. And I never thanked him." You see, at that moment, Betsy and Corey realized the shocking truth. When Yeshua died on the stake, he experienced all the shame and embarrassment that they had come to know because he had died for them. And stripping him bare, the religious and political leaders' intent was to cancel his dignity. The same spirit of today's cancel culture, to expose any or all in our lives that they find offensive and cancel our dignity. The second incident we notice at the stake is Yeshua's turning Miriam over to John for safekeeping, or Yochanan. And we read from John 19, "When Yeshua saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, 'Woman, here is your son.' And then he said to the disciple, 'Here is your mother.' And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home." Now, I chose the rendering from the New Revised Standard Version over the Complete Jewish Bible for a very specific reason. There are two Greek words at play here, where the David Stern has chosen to translate mother for each word. There are actually two distinct words. One that lends itself more to mother, and the other that lends itself more to woman. So that's why I feel that I don't really agree with his translation on this. Even the King James goes with the differentiation between mother and woman with these two Greek words. This being of only seven things that Yeshua said from the tree, I feel it's pretty darn important that we get it right. We don't want to distort what he meant like the Catholic Church has done for centuries. Catholicism believes Mary was the mother of the Son of God. So they venerate her by making statues of her and pray to her, referring to her as Holy Mother. Many of you that are former Catholics have done the same. The Vatican II Catechism, which I have, proudly proclaims that Mary is the mother of the Son of God, so she far surpasses all other creatures. She far surpasses all other creatures, both in heaven and on earth. Doesn't quite line up with Scripture, though. The problem with that is Miriam or Mary, like each of us, have sinned and fallen short. Granted, she was honored to be chosen as the woman who would birth and raise Yeshua, but not because she was superior in any human way than any other. Miriam was chosen because she could be trusted to do what she was called to do, because she was faithful to God. And second, Yeshua never once addressed her as mother. Never once. Yeshua said, "Woman, behold your son." The only other time he addressed her was in John, the second chapter, where Miriam asked him to help at the marriage feast, and he replied, "Woman, what concern is it that you and to me? My hour has not yet come." So Yeshua's final words to Miriam are recorded here at the crucifixion to remind us of a couple things. Miriam was the woman who gave birth to him at Beit Lechem or Bethlehem, so it was his responsibility as the oldest son to make sure that she would be cared for upon his death, which he did, calling upon his trusted Talmid, Yochanan, to honor his request. Second, Yeshua foresaw something. He foresaw people one day treating Miriam as a sort of deity, which is why he was very careful to avoid calling her mother or calling her his mother. They tried to cancel his dignity. They tried to cancel the uniqueness of his deity. They tried to cancel his dignity, I should say. They tried to cancel the uniqueness of his deity. And they even tried to cancel his suffering. His suffering. The third phrase that Yeshua cried out from the stake was what? I thirst. I thirst. And after this, knowing that all things had accomplished their purpose, Yeshua, in order to fulfill the words of the Tanakh, said, I'm thirsty. And a jar full of cheap sour wine was there, so they soaked a sponge in the wine and coated it with oregano leaves and held it up to his mouth. Was Jesus really thirsty? Well, yes, of course. Most definitely he was thirsty. It was real. It was one of the torments of being nailed to a cross, to a stake. And it was prophesied because God wanted us to know that his sufferings were real. In Mark 15:23, as they were preparing to nail him to the stake, we're told they gave him wine spiced with myrrh, but he didn't take it. Why would he refuse it? Well, there's a number of different points of view on this. But according to one commentator, the design of this drink of wine and myrrh was to intoxicate, that those being crucified might not feel their pain and misery so much. Yeshua went to the tree to not avoid pain. No, he went to the tree to experience it and thirst on our behalf to the fullest. John Stott, in his book, The Cross of Christ, wrote, in the real world of pain, which we've all lived in, how could one worship a God who was immune to it? He laid aside his immunity to pain. He entered our world of flesh and blood, tears and death. He suffered for us. Our sufferings become more manageable in light of his. And at last, all the suffering and all the pain were summed up in the fourth and final phrase, and you know what it is. It is finished. And he bowed his head and he gave up his spirit. His task was complete. Everything he had come to do, he did. It was finished. You know, it is finished is a legal term used these days to mean paid in full. Romans 6:23 tells us the wages of sin, you know this, is death. Our sins came at a price, and the price was our death or the death of someone else who could take our place. As our advocate, he represents us, taking our place before the eternal Beit Din, and then he pays our sin penalty from that moment on. Our separation from God due to our sin and rebellion is atoned for. It is finished. Now, where it is over concerning our sins, as far as God is concerned, as for the cancel culture, it's not over. It's not over. Like it is with Hasatan. The cancel culture of our day doesn't forget your sins. In fact, according to the New York Post, there are a few groups on Twitter who have made it their civic duty to scrutinize the actions of average people like you and I and public figures alike, shedding light on previously overlooked or unknown incidents. In other words, it doesn't matter how long ago or how obscure your past sins may have been, if they don't like you, they'll find that sin and do everything in their power to embarrass and shame you with it. Even if your slate is clean, they'll find something to accuse you of. For people like that, there is no forgiveness. There is no mercy. This is the world that we live in today, brothers and sisters. Someone once noted that Hasatan knows your name, but calls you by your sin. Our countercultural Savior, however, will have none of it. Yeshua called canceled people his friends. In fact, his circle of followers included what? A betrayer. We talked about him yesterday. A thief. Prostitute. That's just a few of his buddies. He was unwilling to cancel the worst of the world, the baddest of the bad, and the guiltiest of the guilty. He moved toward those whom society moved away from. He befriended, loved, and touched the outcast, the misfit, the leper, the liar, the sexual deviant. He refused to dismiss those who had been dismissed, reject those who had been rejected, denounce those who had been denounced, and shame those who had been shamed. In fact, his closest friends were of such ill repute that the religious leaders of the day concluded Yeshua must be an imposter, because no self-respecting person of God would embrace those kinds of people like you and I. There's one kind of canceling, however, that Yeshua was all about. He was all about this canceling. Rabbi Shaul wrote about it to Colossae. He said, he wiped away the bill of charges against us because of the regulations. It stood as a testimony against us, but he removed it by nailing it to the execution stake. Maybe this is the reason why Yeshua himself was canceled by his culture and ours. The scandal of his promiscuous love towards those who are hated, his amazing grace to those who are guilty, is just too vulgar for some cultures that has to find some solace in dealing with the uncomfortable log in their own eye by pointing out the minuscule speck in everyone else's. And that's the big difference between Yeshua and cancel culture. While our culture, including the church, cancels people who have done terrible things, Yeshua cancels the terrible things that people are canceled for. The sins and scandals that cancel culture chooses not to forget, Yeshua chooses not to remember. Remember, what did he say? What did he say? It is finished. It's over. What he does remember, and he never forgets, is that he is the friend of sinners, the brother of the outcast, the God of 70 times 7 forgiveness, and the Lord of the redeemed and resurrected lives. The cancel culture of his day failed. And brothers and sisters, they're going to fail today. The enemies of God rejoiced when they thought they had prevailed and canceling Yeshua on the tree, but on Yom HaBikurim, we rejoice in their failure. Success, brothers and sisters, is the greatest revenge. What the cancel culture fails to realize is, in spite of their efforts to destroy lives, our God has always been in the business of redeeming lives out of death. And Yeshua emerged from the tomb in Yom HaBikurim so that we can do the same. There is nothing in the entire world that could have stopped the resurrection of Yeshua HaMashiach 2,000 years ago. And regardless of how offensive he is to the cancel culture, there's nothing that will ever cancel that reality today, no matter to whom it offends. Job was right. Our Redeemer lives. And so shall we. And that's a truth that will never be canceled. Hallelujah. Amen. Ted Pierce is a prophetic voice. These are the final days. Please rise. Mr. Carlton.
Go ahead and read from Psalm 67. God, be gracious to us and bless us. May he make his face shine upon us, so that your way may be known on the earth, your salvation among all nations. Let the peoples give thanks to you, God. Let the peoples give thanks to you, all of them. Let the nations be glad and shout for joy. For you will judge the peoples fairly. Amen. And guide the nations on the earth. Let the peoples give thanks to you, God. Let the peoples give thanks to you, all of them. The earth has yielded its harvest. May God, our God, bless us. May God continue to bless us so that all the ends of the earth will fear him. Amen.
So why do we read that, brother?
I was supposed to say that.
We read that because there are 49 words in that psalm. And we begin the counting of the Omer leading up to the 50th day, the Penti of Shavuot, to Pentecost. I need a helper. Who's my helper? I already got one. There you go, big guy. All right, go out in front there. Show them. Amen. Join with me in the blessing as we begin to count up to Shavuot. Amen. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam asher kiddushanu b'mitzvotav v'tzivanu al seferot ha'omer. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has sanctified us by your commandments and has instructed us concerning the counting of the Omer. Amen. Hallelujah.
Reason, hallelujah.
Sing a little louder.
raise your hallelujah today. He is risen. God bless you. God bless you all. Hugs a man.
Disciples sitting more.